Hello everyone, I am Dr. Shweta Suryakant, fellow in vitro retina and ocular oncology. On behalf of the Vitro Retinal Society of India, I welcome you all to an interesting episode of New Retina Roundup, presenting to you five interesting articles published in December 2021. So let's start. The first one is a study from Brazil, which has analyzed surgical performance of novice vitro retinal surgeons after different types of external exposures. They found that the surgical performance worsened after increasing levels of alcohol exposure. It doesn't stop there. They also found that caffeine negatively impacted surgical performance. Contrary to the popular belief, acute sleep deprivation and exercise did not seem to affect the surgical performance. So a cocktail or maybe even a coffee on the day before your theater is a bad idea. Moving on, in the era of increasing use of anti-VEGFs for treating proliferative diabetic retinopathy, the importance of close follow-up cannot be stressed enough. However, a post-hoc analysis of Protocol S of DRCR.net has reported that over 5 years, approximately half of the participants assigned to ranibizumab group had a long lapse in care and one-third of them dropped out of follow-up despite substantial effort by the DRCR group. This practical consideration could be important in planning the management of patients. So, how would you counsel your next patient plan for anti-VEGF treatment? Up next, the fear of retinal vasculitis or retinal vascular occlusion following dolosuzumab was the talk of the town last year. We look into an unmasked post-hoc analysis of Hawk and Harrier clinical trials. A significant number of cases that developed retinal vasculitis and retinal vascular occlusion were reported to have had preceding intraocular inflammation. Few of these patients received one or more of the injections even after the first intraocular inflammatory adverse event. So do you think being vigilant about this inflammatory event could have potentially prevented the vasculitis or occlusion adverse event? Moving ahead, we have an article from China which has described non-invasive clinical criteria to diagnose ocular toxocariasis with excellent sensitivity and specificity in comparison with immunological diagnostic modalities. They studied 9 clinical manifestations and came up with 3 most common and consistent features, namely presence of retrolental membrane, branch-like vitreous strands, and retinal granulomas. The presence of at least 2 out of these 3 clinical features was strongly correlated with immunological positivity. The final one addresses one of the most common clinical problems we see in retina practice, the macular edema. Oral administration of fenofibrate is known to have therapeutic effect on macular edema in diabetic patients. How about topical fenofibrate? Never heard of it? Well, you will hear it now. A nano-emulsion-based fenofibrate eye drop formulation that delivers significantly higher amounts of the drug to the retina compared to the systemic administration has been developed. This formulation decreases leukocytes adherent to retinal vasculature and attenuates overexpression of multiple inflammatory factors in the retina. So it has been found to be beneficial, not just in diabetic retinopathy patients, but also in choroidal neovascularization, secondary to both AMD and also secondary to laser. Well, that's it for today. Hope you found this video useful. The abstracts of all the articles that we discussed are enclosed here with. See you next month with yet another episode of the New Retina Roundup. Until then, take care and keep the inquisitiveness on. Thank you so much for your patience.